sun humbles itself every time, every few hours. And we remind ourselves that even the sun is submitted to Allah. So around that clock that Ibrahim alayhi salam even made reference to, the five daily prayers occur. Now, then comes the matter of Hajj. And Hajj, if you pay attention at Hajj, of course, we're doing Hajj of the house built by who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. We're slaughtering the animal because of who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Jamarat goes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Maqam Ibrahim, literally. وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى. Every major ritual of the Hajj goes back to that man, Ibrahim alayhi salam. So I've talked to you about Shahada, I've talked to you about Salah, I talked to you about Hajj. I should talk a little bit, what about Ramadan? I'll get to Ramadan in a second. Even Ramadan goes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Most people don't realize. Ibrahim alayhi salam made a prayer. He said, رَبَّنَا وَابْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. Send a messenger among them who will recite your revelations. Now who is that messenger? It's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what is that revelation? It's the Qur'an. When was the Qur'an revealed? In the month of Ramadan, Laylatul Qadr. And instead of celebrating the month of Ramadan in one night, because when one event happens, you celebrate it on one night. And even though this event, Allah Himself tells us, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. We sent it down in the night of power, that one night. But that one night is not enough to celebrate the Qur'an. The entire month is dedicated to celebrate the revelation of the Qur'an. And the revelation of the Qur'an is directly a result of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Four out of our five pillars go back straight to Ibrahim alayhi salam. We are the religion of Ibrahim. As a matter of fact, one time I was just talking about the Hajj, nothing else. I was talking to a gathering of non-Muslims. And in the first row, there was a rabbi sitting there, a very highly qualified rabbi. He's got a degree out of, you know, a Western university in Jewish studies, and also out of a school in Tel Aviv, right? Double PhDs, 23 years studying the Jewish tradition. He's sitting in the first row, and I was talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam. And I was only talking about the Hajj and what the Muslims do at Hajj and how this is a religion of Abraham. Like, if anybody says we are part of the Abrahamic faiths, nobody has the right to say that more than the Muslims. Why? Because we have a convention numbering in the millions every single year that celebrate every single sacrifice made by Ibrahim alayhi salam. One after the other after the other. And the rabbi sitting in the first row was crying his face off. He's just bawling in tears. Listening, I'm not trying to talk to him, I'm talking to the Muslims in the audience. But he's crying his face off because he's hearing things about Ibrahim alayhi salam that he hasn't even realized. You know, and we became good friends after that. It's okay, you can be friends. You know? We started talking, we hung out a couple of times. It actually sounds like a strange joke, you know, a rabbi and a Muslim hang out at a kosher restaurant in Texas. It doesn't make sense, but it happened, you know. But anyway, coming back to this, Allah introduces the Jewish community to reintroduces them to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Why was that important? Because now their chances, one after the other prophet, those chances are finished. You were given all the chances you could have. That last messenger that you were given was Isa alayhi salam. And that's it. You even tried to kill him. It's over. Now the honor of messengership goes over to the other side, and it's time to fulfill that dua. That original dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and that is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Which means now the people who follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are the chosen ummah. They are the new ummah, that the new nation that Allah has given the responsibility for representing Allah's revelation on the earth. What is God's message to humanity on the earth? Humanity will not know unless they look at the followers of this man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this ummah, ummatu Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this is a huge responsibility, but I want you to understand, a new nation has been formed. I know this is about Ramadan, you'll see how in a second. A new nation has been formed. The nation is called ummatan wasata in the Quran. And understand how it's been formed. You know, when you have a new nation, you need a new capital. Whenever you have a new nation, you need a what? A capital. And so the capital was restored, so that now we pray, instead of praying towards Jerusalem, we're going to pray towards Mecca. Because that is the capital of Islam now. And it goes back to the founding father, Ibrahim alayhi salam. That's why it was important to mention, إِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ. It's going back to the original. This is the capital of Islam on the earth, the Kaaba, the house that was built by Ibrahim alayhi salam. So now the Muslims have to change the direction of prayer. Anybody know which way you used to pray until the ayat came down? Towards what? Towards Jerusalem, isn't it? Which means until the Prophet was told otherwise, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would do exactly the same rituals that were given to Musa alayhi salam. Because these are not two different religions. The religion given to Musa is also Islam. It's not Judaism, it's Islam. And the religion given to the Prophet ﷺ is also Islam. So he used to fast on the same days. They used to fast on the same days as the Jews. And then they used to pray in the same direction as the Jews. Muslims used to pray in the same direction. And as a matter of fact, even the celebration of Ashura is taken from them. In other words, Allah did not let the Muslims see that they are a different religion. They are a tasdeeq, a confirmation. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِنَ التَّوْرَاتِ. It's just a confirmation of what was given to the previous messenger, Musa alayhi salam. You know, we don't think about this enough. We think of the Jews as some other thing. Allah talks more about Musa alayhi salam in the Quran than any other prophet. Any other prophet. That's significant. This is not it's not an accident in the Quran. The greatest role model given, the case study given to us as a nation is Banu Israel. And the messenger most talked about, even when the Prophet ﷺ is worried about the Quran. You know, ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى. A couple of ayat later, هل أتاك حديث موسى? Even to him, for motivation, Allah talks about Musa عليه السلام. Because that was a messenger that was given the closest thing to the Quran before, which was the Torah. Now, we used to fast on the same days, and we used to pray in the same what? Direction. But now we are a new nation. We are now a new nation. So it needs a new capital. So what does Allah do in Surah Al-Baqarah? He changes the direction of the Qibla. That's the first symbol that we are now a new nation. But that's not the only thing that makes us a new nation. Now, for now and forever, whatever they were given in Torah, because that Torah was their constitution, yes? So a new nation needs a capital, but a new nation also needs a what? A constitution. And their constitution was the Torah. But Allah says that Torah is no longer applicable. This new nation has a new constitution, which is what? The Quran. And so the day on which this constitution was inaugurated, which is Laylatul Qadr, that should be celebrated. And this entire month that we're celebrating in Ramadan is us celebrating ourselves as a new nation. This is part of us being a unique ummah. It's part of the Muslim identity that we're celebrating Ramadan and we're celebrating our constitution, which is the Quran. That's what we're doing in Ramadan. It's an incredible thing. It actually directly has to do with our identity. It doesn't have to do with pakoda and samosa, auntie, I'm sorry. It doesn't. It doesn't have to do with sleeping in the middle of Taraweeh, like, you know, waiting for the ruku'ah. You hear, the most supreme Allahu Akbar you hear is when the imam goes into ruku'ah. Allahu Akbar. You know, we missed the point. We missed the point entirely. So now, I'm going to go through some of these ayat and show you how that from that old nation, now we're switching over to the new nation and what this signifies. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam, kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum. Those of you who believe, fasting was made mandatory upon you, it was prescribed, it was made the law for you to follow, just like it was for the people who came before you. It was written on them too. In other words, your fasting was exactly the same as their fasting. There was no difference. You used to fast on exactly the same day. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So that you may be able to protect yourselves. So that you may be able to protect yourselves. Now we have to this ayah is about the purpose of fasting, not the purpose of Ramadan. Let's make a distinction. We're going to look at this carefully today or tonight. There's a difference between the purpose of fasting and the purpose of what? Ramadan. This ayah, this first ayah, is not about the purpose of Ramadan. It is about the purpose of fasting. Now let's understand it. Allah says the purpose of fasting is that you learn to protect yourself. You learn to become cautious of Allah. You learn to take extra precaution. How in the world is that possible? How is fasting teaching me precaution? This requires a little bit of thinking. You know, when you're fasting, you're hungry. You're thirsty, especially if you're in Qatar. You're really thirsty. Right? Your throat feels the thirst, yes or no? It feels, by 12 o'clock, you're already dying. And it gets worse. And your throat sends a message to your mind, to your heart. I need drink. I need drink. There's a war going on inside your body, isn't it? Your stomach is saying, feed me. Your throat is saying, give me drink. Replenish me. I'm drying up. Your tongue is constantly asking you for drink. You're gulping down your own saliva. And it's uncomfortable. And there's this one part of your body, only one part, which is your heart. Your heart is saying to your throat, shut up, not until Maghrib. Your stomach starts crying, your heart says to the stomach, shut up, not until Maghrib. You understand? There are desires inside your body, feeling hungry and feeling thirsty and feeling temptation. That's not haram. That's not haram. But Allah gave this one thing in our entire body. There's only one limb, the heart. It keeps defeating our body in the entire day of the fast. Isn't that the case? You know what that is? That is taqwa. Taqwa is when your body wants something, your other limbs want something, your eyes want something, your tongue wants something, your hands want something, your hormones want something, and there's only one thing inside you that says, no, shut up, not until it's halal. And what's that? Your heart. And a taqwa lies inside the heart. فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ We're conditioning our heart. That's all we're doing in the month of Ramadan. Even the guy that's not religious, he doesn't even pray regularly. He doesn't even pray. Even he's holding himself from eating and drinking, even though you should be praying. Even he's holding himself. You know what that's proof of? He can also develop taqwa. And if you can train yourself for 30 days, 30 rigorous, hot, intense, oh my God, days, and deprive yourself constantly, 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 that is an incredible training for your heart to be able to win even when this month is over. That's what the point of it is. So now Allah says, you were given fasting so you could develop taqwa, you could become conscious. You know, these are things that are halal. The apple you're looking at, or the orange juice, or whatever that's staring at you, it's halal. But not until Maghrib. Outside the rest of the year, it's actually halal whenever you want. You know, after Ramadan is over, sometimes you're just sitting there and there's a piece of chocolate looking at you. You're not looking at it, it's looking at you. And then you eat it and for a second you feel guilty, like, whoa, wait, Ramadan's over. Oh yeah. That happens to me every year, by the way. Every year. You know, chocolate starts looking at me. But anyway, what I'm trying to get at is that even after Ramadan, that caution remains for a little bit. But you know, Allah taught us to have caution not over the haram things. He taught us to have caution over permissible things. Why? Because if you can stop yourself from the permissible, it should be way easier now for you to stop yourself from the impermissible. Because the impermissible is very few things. It's not many things. Allah opened up to most of what He created on this earth. خَلَقَ لَكُم مَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا The vast majority of what He made on this earth is for your benefit. He didn't make it haram. Haram is very few things. Now it's easy for you. So the entire point of Ramadan is to train you for what's going to happen after. This, by the way, this was the point of fasting, not Ramadan, I apologize. Now Allah says, أَيَّامَ مَعْدُودَاتِ مَعْدُودَاتِ in Arabic is called جَمْعُ قِلَّةِ In other words, a handful of days, less than 10. If it was أَيَّامَ مَعْدُودَ with a tamarbuta, it would have been more. Allah is referring to the fact that before Ramadan came, we used to fast the same way as the people of the book, and it used to be just a few days. Now Allah says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا This is the part you're going to have to pay attention to. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ If somebody is traveling, or they're sick among you, what can they do? They can make it up other time. So if you miss the official fast, we're not talking about Ramadan yet. Ramadan is in the next ayah. But even the previous fasting, because we used to fast on the same days as the Jews, if you miss one of them, what could you do if you got sick or you were traveling? You could make it up later. Now, that's option number one. Option number one, you make it up later. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ And those who were capable of fasting and they still didn't fast. In other words, they weren't sick and they weren't traveling, but they didn't feel like fasting. They didn't do it anyway. What could they do? They could give a fidya. They could compensate by feeding a poor person. Ta'amu miskin. Option number one was what? What was option number one? You make it up. What's option number two? You can feed a poor person. If you miss it, you can feed a poor person. That's option number two. وَمَن تَطَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَّهُ And whoever volunteers to do good, even if you want to feed a poor person on your own anyway, good for you. If you want to make up the fast and feed a poor person, good for you. وَأَن تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ If you were to fast, it's better, if you actually knew. What I'm trying to get at is in the original fasting, if you mess up, there are two options. You can make it up, or you can give fidyah. Those were the two options. Now we're coming to the ayah of Ramadan. What does Allah say about Ramadan? Here's where the fun begins. شَهْرُ Ramadan, the month of Ramadan. When you hear the month of Ramadan, what's the first thing that comes in your head? Fasting. That's what the first thing that's comes in my head is fasting. I have to deprogram myself. شَهْرُ Ramadan الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ The month of Ramadan is the one in which the Qur'an was sent down. The first thought in my head about Ramadan needs to be that this is the month in which Allah gave His greatest gift to humanity, the Qur'an. That is what makes this month special, not fasting. Fasting has its own benefit. Ramadan's ultimate benefit is it connected humanity to the word of Allah. That is the purpose of Ramadan. الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ Now, this is a Madani surah, which means the Qur'an has been coming for a long time now. Two-thirds of the Qur'an already revealed. Now we're already 6-7 months into Medina, and these ayat are coming. And when these ayat are coming, the Muslims, some people have been Muslim for more than a decade. They're very seasoned Muslims, and they know a lot of Qur'an. And they know what Qur'an is. Now listen to these ayat. الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ Guidance for humanity. Ask yourself this. Do the Muslims already know that Qur'an is guidance for humanity? They already know. If you ask any Muslim at the time, before this ayah came down, what is Qur'an? They may have said, Hudal linnas, is guidance for humanity. Why is Allah reintroducing the Qur'an? You know why? Because this month, even if you have been Muslim your whole life, even if you're among the Sahaba who've been Muslim for over a decade now, and have struggled with the Prophet ﷺ and made hijrah with him, when this month comes, reintroduce yourself to the Qur'an like you never knew it before. Hudal linnas. And he didn't even say, Hudal lil mu'mineen, lil muslimin, lil muttaqeen. Nope, Hudal linnas. Guidance for people, all people. You know what that means? This is the month to share the guidance of the Qur'an with people. This is the month to talk to your non-Muslim co-worker about the Qur'an. Share something about the Qur'an with them. You don't have to convert them. Just share something of Allah's guidance with them. Share something with them about the story of Musa alayhi salam. Say something about what Allah says about Dawud alayhi salam. Something good. Just something of benefit. This is supposed to be guidance for all humanity. And there's another important reason why this was said. What was the previous revelation before the Qur'an? Torah. Was that for all humanity? No, it was only for Bani Israel. وَجَعَلْنَاهُ هُدًى لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ But this Qur'an did not come for the Arabs, did not come for the Jews. Who did it come for? All of humanity. It came for the Bangladeshis, it came for the Filipinos, it came for the Australians, it came for the Americans. It's supposed to be for everybody. هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ Share it with people. I'll tell you a crazy story. Some of you may have heard me talk about it before. I have a good friend who works at a university, and he tries to talk to his co-workers about Islam every chance he gets. So one of his co-workers who's a Christian, he talks to him about the Qur'an, and every time he talks to him, this guy starts having an allergic reaction. Literally, his eyes start getting red, he starts sneezing, he starts coughing, his eyes get, like, allergic reaction. Every time he says something about Qur'an. And he's been trying for years. He just says, hey, you know, by the way, there's a surah in the Qur'an, it says, and the guy goes, Every time. And so one time they were flying in Ramadan. And he turns to him and he was reciting Qur'an. And he was worried about reciting Qur'an because every time Qur'an happens, his friend who's next to him goes crazy. But this time his friend is completely fine. No allergic reaction, nothing. Shayateen, what happens to shayateen in the month of Ramadan? They're chained. Allah says it's an opportunity to give guidance to people that you will not get other time. Even the hearts of non-Muslims are going to be softer in Ramadan than they will be in other times of the year. It's an incredible opportunity. Hudal linnas. Then he says, وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ This is awesome too. And clear proofs from within the guidance. What does that mean? Let me try to explain what بَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى means. when you engage the Quran in the month of Ramadan, amazing things will happen that you will not be able to explain to anybody else. You're going to come to Allah's book looking for guidance. You're going to just open up a surah and start reciting, and you're going to be like, that was the problem I was having. Allah just solved it in this ayah. I can't believe that. How did that happen? How did Allah know? Every time you pay attention to the word of Allah, it will actually clearly give you personally guidance. بَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى. Clearly, personally, each of you will receive something from guidance, and myself included, if we're seeking it. If we're seeking it. And that's the kind of guidance, you cannot prove it to anybody else. You cannot argue with that with somebody else. When you experience it, it is for who? For yourself. For nobody else. But what about everybody else? That's why Allah says, وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. That's furqan. Furqan means you can separate the right from the wrong, the clear from the confusing, the truth from the falsehood. In other words, the Quran will not just be a personal miracle for you, but it will have in it proof that can make it clear to everybody that this can only be the word of Allah. I want to share with you a recent story from Kuwait, actually. A good friend of mine now, Professor Raymond Farron, he's a professor of Arabic. At American University of Kuwait. He's out of, originally from New Jersey. So he lives in Kuwait now for 8 years. He's written a couple of books on the Quran too. And I'll tell you, he did his PhD at Georgetown University in Arabic. So he's one of those Americans that, you know, Americans like to study weird things. Like they could do a PhD on ants. You'll never find a Pakistani guy doing a PhD on ants. We won't even read an article on ants. But these guys do PhDs on flowers and ants and whatever. And this guy decides, I'm interested in Arabic. So he decides to do a PhD in Arabic. And he does a specialization in Shi'r Jahili, classical Arabic poetry. And in classical Arabic poetry, his PhD thesis was, how is it organized? Because you know, sometimes the Qasida is really long, the poetry is really long, and he wanted to see what's the structure that the Arab poet used to use to organize his poem. And he did a PhD paper on it. And after his PhD paper, he decided to do a second paper. He got curious about the Quran because, you know, for the non-Muslims in their universities, Quran is just another kind of poetry. To them, it's not the book of Allah. To them, it's just poetry, you know? So he decides to do a paper on the structure of the surahs of the Quran. That's what he decided to research on his own. He's not doing this for religious reasons. He's just doing this because he's a guy that studies literature. That's what he's doing. And as he studies it, he tells me, this happened to him 8 years ago, when he wrote his first article, he realized this cannot possibly be done by a human being. He became Muslim. He took Shahada. Nobody gave him da'wah. Nobody preached Islam to him. Nobody taught him how to pray. Nobody taught him how to make wudu. Nobody told him Allah is one. Nothing. This guy, all he knew was classical poetry, and then he started doing some of his own research on the Quran. And just from the way the book of Allah is organized, he said to himself, this can only be the word of God. When I met him a couple of months ago in Kuwait, we were just sitting there talking, and I was talking to him about one of his articles. One of his articles was on Surah Al-Rahman. And I was telling him how much I appreciated the structure that he analyzed. He goes, yeah, of course, it can only be from God. It's totally obvious. I was like, yeah, it is totally obvious. You know, that's Furqan. That's furqan. You can distinguish between, you know, right and wrong right away. Right away. Just this happened 3 weeks ago to me. I was at a convention in Washington, D.C., near Washington, D.C., and a young woman came up to me, one young girl, 15 years old. She says, you know, I'm from a Muslim family, but how do we know the Quran is Allah's word? How do we know it can only be from God? I mean, every religion says their book is from God. The Hindus say their book is from God's. You know, the Christians say theirs is God's book. The Jews say theirs is God's book. How do we know ours is the right one and theirs is the wrong one? How are we supposed to know? So I said, just come over here, up here. I sat her down next to me. I drew some things from a couple of surahs on a piece of paper. And I said, can a human being do that? And she goes, no. I was like, that's how we know. She goes, oh, okay. Problem solved. That's Furqan. In other words, the book of Allah makes it extremely clear that it cannot be a human being's effort. We didn't give it that chance. And I'm going to spend a little bit extra time on this subject because it's important for Muslims to hear. Nowadays, Islam is being taught in a way. Islam is being taught in the Muslim world and in the West. Islam is being taught in a way that makes atheism easy. It makes not believing in Allah easy. Because it's not being taught in a way that convinces a young man and a young woman this can only be from Allah. All they're taught is this is halal and this is haram. You're going to go to Jahannam for this, 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 and this. Which means chances are you're going to Jahannam. That's all we're taught. And Jannah is for very few people, not you. I mean, look at you. You're going to go to Jannah? No, not you. Those were really good people. And most of them died a long time ago. So they're already there. You know, people get so turned off by religion in the Muslim world. You don't know how many thousands of emails I get from people that are losing their religion in the Muslim world, in the Arab world, in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, all over. College students, teenagers, high school students that are not sure about Islam or about any religion now. They're not even sure about any religion. And you know when that happens? When you lose sight of the fact that every single year, when Ramadan comes, what was the ummah supposed to do? First of all, الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ, experience personal guidance from the Qur'an. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَىٰ وَالْفُرْقَانِ, and review for yourself and myself what makes this an absolute word of Allah. It cannot be anything else. We have to remind ourselves of its miracle. We have to remind ourselves of its perfection. This has to be done, and it has to be done in every generation's language. If we're living in 2015, then we have to describe the power of the Qur'an in 2015's language. If we were living in the 1700s, then it's the language of the 1700s. This is what we have to do if we're going to save this faith, because people are losing their faith. Muslims are thinking, this is just our book. You know, the Christians have their book, we have our book, so what? You know, I'm just Muslim because my parents were Muslim. That's good enough. No, it's not good enough. That is the kind of iman that will get shaken very quickly, by the way. We are living in times where you're going to get exposed to ideas outside. You know, whether it's on YouTube or it's at the university or it's on Facebook, you're going to see other ideas. And if you don't have a foundation in your religion, it's going to go so quickly. So quickly. It won't be anything left. This is why Al-Furqan needs to be highlighted. The distinction between truth and falsehood. The power and the miracle of this Quran needs to be highlighted. Now, Allah says, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ, whoever of you witnesses the month, they should fast it. شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ. Allah says Ramadan is something to be witnessed. Ramadan is something to be witnessed. This is ishara in the Quran. To witness something, you have to be awake, yes? Yeah. You know what that's an indication of? You should be witnessing Ramadan. You can't witness something if you're sleeping most of the day. You understand what I'm saying to you, Qatar? You hear what I'm saying? Okay, I heard your stories over here. People go to Fajr, then they wake up for Dhuhr, then they wake up for Asr, then they stay up for Maghrib for a long time. Then they drag themselves to Isha because they ate too much food. And then they party all night until Fajr. And then the hibernation begins again. Shahida minkum ash-shahra. Your job is to share the word of Allah, not party all night. Your job is to engage the word of Allah. This is the month of the Quran, guys. Reinstate the relationship between your family and the Quran. I'm not even saying go out on the street and do da'wah. I'm saying just talk to your family. Our families are disconnected from the Quran. Our families don't know Surah Al-Baqarah. Our families don't know Ibrahim alayhi salam anymore. Come on. We got to go back and review this book and reappreciate it for ourselves. This is the month to do it. If there was ever a month that was going to do it for you, it's going to be this month. I pray that Allah Azza wa Jalla helps you do that. وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Here's a review. Whoever misses a fast, what could they do? What could they do? Call it out. It's okay. It's not a khutbah. You don't lose your good deeds. You make it up. What was option number two? You pay fidya. No more. That was before. When Ramadan came, then you have to make it up. There's no second option, pay fidya. No. That's gone. If you just didn't feel like fasting, I'll make it up in April. No. I'll make it up in the winter when it's convenient. You have to make it, you can't just pay fidya and feed somebody. You have to make it up. In other words, things got harder. Now please follow what I'm trying to say. Before Ramadan, did we have to fast 30 days? No, it was ayyam ma'dudat. It was a few days. Which is easier or harder? What do you think? It's easier. Now, when you did mess up, how many options did you have? Two options, which is also easier, yes? Now Ramadan came and we have 30 days. 30 days in a row or 30 days broken up? 30 days. Is that easier or harder? That's harder. And now instead of two options, you only have one option. Is that easier or harder? It's harder. Everything just got harder, yes? Everything just got harder. And Allah says right after that, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ Allah wants ease for you. Allah wants things to be easy for you. I'm reading this going, Ya Allah, you just made things harder. And then you told me you want what? Ease. وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ And He doesn't want difficulty for you. So first I have to explain to you what this means. Because if you read the text, it seems the exact opposite. It would sound like Allah wants things to be harder now and not easier, because it's more days. How are we going to survive 30 days in the summer? You know? Now let's appreciate what's being said here. I'm going to give you an analogy, and follow along with the analogy. It's going to sound like I'm not even talking about the Quran, but I am. You guys know about fitness training, right? When you have a trainer, and you first start, is it easy or difficult? It's extremely difficult. It's painful, you will cry, you will sweat, you will want to give up. And the trainer says to you, if you can survive the first 30 days, you are going to be healthier, you're going to take better care of yourself, you're going to eat better, you're going to feel stronger, and by the time, you're 25 right now, but by the time you're 45, you're actually going to be standing up straight. When you're 65, you can still run around and walk around. This is going to make your life easier when? In the long term. But right now, if you want your life to get easier, what do you have to do? You have to put work in. Does the same thing happen at school? When you go to a top school, you have to do more work? And if you have to do the more work now, what's going to be easier when you're done? Your career is going to be easier. Getting a job is going to be easier. Isn't that the case? There's a rule of Allah in place. When you do hard work now, you reap the benefits in the long term. And people who take it easy right now, what happens to them? They suffer the consequences in the long term. There are two friends, one of them exercises, one of them takes care of his health, the other one doesn't, the one eats whatever he wants. Both of them 30 years later, one of them has diabetes, he's in the hospital every other week, he's got high blood pressure, he's got sugar, the other one is playing sports. He's a grandfather and he's playing sports. Why? Because they put the work in early. Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us the month of Ramadan is in fact harder, but this difficulty will save your life. It will save your life. Allah wants your life to be easy for you. He doesn't want you to have difficulty. These 30 days of training, if you do them correctly, will save you for 11 months. It'll save you from shaitan for 11 months if you do it right. It will hold you over. And if you don't do it right, and if you don't give it its due, then you're going to have a lot of difficulty. That's what you're going to have. You know the revelation of Allah, the Quran, the guidance, the sharia of this deen. Allah calls it, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ Allah wants to lighten your burden. He wants to take it easy on you. Allah did not give us these religious restrictions because He wants things to be difficult for us. He wants things to be easier for us. Taqwa will become easier. Guys, you know how many khutbas you've heard about you have to have taqwa? I've heard so many I can't even remember. Because I can remember that I fell asleep in most of them. We have to have taqwa. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullah. You should have taqwa, taqwa, taqwa. I'm like, how do I get taqwa? Where do I get it from? Is it outside in the store? Where do I get taqwa from? Where am I supposed to get it? It's this idea that how are you supposed to bring it in your life? You know what Allah said? Fasting can bring it in your life. Fasting can bring taqwa in your life. And 30 straight days of fasting can bring a lot of taqwa in your life. Enough for you to use the rest of the year. You see what I'm saying to you? Our survival on this earth, our survival with guidance, is with taqwa. That's why in the beginning of this surah, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدَلْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ فَكَيْفَ نَتَّقِي How do we create this taqwa in ourselves? That's what Ramadan came for. That's what fasting came for. Now let's talk about Ramadan itself. And you know what Allah is going to say after He says, He wants ease for you. He doesn't want difficulty for you. He says, وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ So you could complete the count. You know, any serious training has a number of days. You have to in college, you have to finish this many semesters. In police academy training, there's 45 days, 60 days, 90 days, whatever training they have. In the military, they have training, and you have to finish the course, and there's a set number of days you have to finish. In physical training, in athlete training, in college training, any training you have, there are a set number of days. And until you do it, you do not graduate. If you don't meet the requirements, you don't graduate. He says, لِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ. You have to fulfill the count. You have to fulfill the count. This is a kind of, your training is now going to be complete when you fulfill the count. And when you fulfill your training, any training in the world, whether it's, you know, the military academy or police academy, whether it's a college or university, whether it's training for athletes or anything else, when they complete the training, isn't there a graduation ceremony? Every time? Anything you graduate from, there's a ceremony at the end. Now, what is the way that Muslims celebrate? They say takbir, isn't it? And what is the act, what is the ritual, what is the celebration that Muslims have at the end of Ramadan? Eid. And what do we do at Eid? We do takbir, we celebrate. We celebrate the completion of our training for the year. We just graduated. That's why he says, وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. So you declare Allah's greatness based on how He guided you. Subhanallah. We just finished this training, and now we just graduated. Allah says He wants you to celebrate. And He wants you to declare Allah's greatness. How great Allah is that He let you through this entire month. One secret about this ayah I didn't share with you. Very beautiful. Allah Azza wa Jal describes He wants ease for you, and He does not want difficulty. Try this yourself. Fast any other day other than Ramadan. Any other day other than Ramadan. It's going to be 10 times harder. Fast in Ramadan, and Allah will make it what? Easy. Guaranteed. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ. Trust me, I'll make it easy for you. Basically. Allah is giving you some, He'll give you ability you did not have. You did not, if you fasted outside of Ramadan, maybe you can't even handle it. But in Ramadan, He'll give you strength that you didn't have. And that makes you declare Allah's greatness. Because He puts potential and capability in you that you didn't already have on your own. This is the blessing of the Qur'an, that everything gets enhanced. Everything gets barakah in this month. What a powerful month. Now, he says, وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Finally, he says, and so hopefully you'll be grateful. Hopefully, maybe you'll become grateful. The question is, grateful for what? What is the ni'mah in this ayah? Because when you have shukr, you have to have a ni'mah, you know? And the ni'mah, the blessing in this ayah, is the first words. شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ Al-Qur'an. You become grateful. First and foremost, you become grateful and appreciative of the Qur'an. In other words, when these 30 days of long nights of prayer and recitation of Qur'an and sitting there and doing ta'ammul and tadabbur on the Qur'an, reflecting on the Qur'an, when this incredible month of the shaitan's distractions being chained away, when this month is over, you'll become more grateful for the Qur'an and your relationship with this book will continue. You know what we do in Ramadan? What the culture I grew up in? You fast the entire month. And then towards the, after the 27th, you're already in a party. After the 27th of Ramadan. And once Eid comes, forget it. It's like we didn't even have a month of Ramadan. The Eid party itself undoes the entire worship. It cancels the whole thing out. Forget everything. You know why? Because our month of Ramadan was just about the rituals. It wasn't about actually reconnecting with the word of Allah. So we have to restore that. Now, inshallah, as I close, I want to share with you a few very powerful things. One of the gifts Allah gave us in Ramadan, one of the most powerful gifts Allah gave us in Ramadan, is not just that He gave us He spoke to us, but He gave us a chance to speak to Him. Let me say that again. Quran is when Allah speaks to us. Dua is when we speak to Him. When you connect with His word, when you start listening to Him, when you allow Him to speak to you, now you are in a position to speak to Him. That's why in the next ayah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. One of the most beautiful, powerful, just mind-blowing ayat on the concept of dua in the entire Quran is here. Allah says, وَإِذَا, whenever my slave asks you about me. Now think about that. Allah Azza wa Jal, there's nobody more important than Allah. No one is more important than Allah. But you know, in this life, there are people that are important. Somebody's in a position of governance. Somebody's the CEO of a company. Somebody is speaking. Somebody's teaching. They're in a position of importance. Or somebody's a doctor, a specialized doctor. I was reminded one of my children needed a specialist. We need to take them to a specialist. And this specialist, 6-month waiting list. Now, if you miss your appointment, after 6 months, if you're 20 minutes late, guess what? another 6 months. It's gone. When people are very specialized and very important, then you have to make time for them. They don't make time for you. You have to make time for them. Isn't that the case? No one is more important than Allah. And Allah says, whenever He asks me, you don't have to make a special time with Allah. Allah is there, accessible to you constantly. Subhanallah. What a gift from Allah that He's constantly accessible. You know, people come sometimes and ask me, what's the best time to make dua? When people want to ask me, yes, there are special times to make dua, but I say, you know what? Anytime. Just make dua, dude. Just make, don't wait. Just make dua. Allah is listening. Now, look at this. I'll give you an example. Again, silly examples get the point across. There's a mother who sent her son to America. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So he's going to America to get a college education. And it's been 6 months. And she's talking about her son. And what does she say? You tell me, what is she going to say? When my son comes back, I will cook for him? Or is she going to say, if my son comes back, I will cook for him? Is she going to say, when my son comes back, or if my son comes back? She's going to say, when my son comes back, I'm going to cook for him. She will never say what? If my son comes. Why not? Because she cannot accept the possibility that he might not come back. She has full hope and full conviction that he will come back. Isn't that the case? Allah Azza wa Jal did not say, wa in sa'alaka ibadi anni. He said, wa idha sa'alaka ibadi anni. When my slave asks you about me, not if my slave asks you about me. Allah is waiting for you to ask. He's not saying, maybe you'll ask, maybe you don't ask. Allah has full anticipation and expectation that you will ask about Him. Subhanallah. The optimism of Allah, the expectation from you. We give up hope on ourselves. Allah does not give up hope in us. Allah does not give up hope even in the one of you that has never prayed in their entire life. That hasn't even gone to Jumu'ah. The adhan is so loud you can't even hear yourself speak. You still don't go to the masjid. Everybody's going this way, you're going that way. Doesn't matter. Even that guy, even when you turn back to Allah, Allah is waiting for you. إِذَا سَأَلَكْ. You know, in Arabic rhetoric, they say, if you say إِذَا يَسْأَلُكْ, then it means continual asking. المُضَارِعْ يَدُلُ عَلَى الْإِسْتِمْرَارِ. That the present tense alludes to something, he keeps asking, keeps asking, keeps asking. But in this ayah, even if he asked one time, this guy never asked anything about Allah. He asked one time, this girl asked one time about Allah. Even for that person, this ayah is open. Then he says in this ayah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. عِبَادِي, my slaves. When they ask you about me, they ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So beautiful, so beautiful. If you want to know about Allah, who do you go to? You go to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, some people think the Quran, it does not emphasize the importance of the Prophet himself. I don't know what Quran these people are reading. If you want to get to know Allah, Allah Himself says, who should you be asking? His Messenger. When they ask you about me, when my slaves ask you about me, and by the way, he used the word ibadi. Ibad comes from abd. Abd is a slave. And you would say, this person is a good abd, meaning they worship Allah, they obey Allah, they pray, they fast, they don't consume the haram. But actually, in this ayah, anybody, any human being on this earth falls under ibad. It doesn't even matter if you're not even Muslim yet, you're still under ibad. If they just ask you about me, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, then absolutely I am near. Some people feel like Allah has gone far away from them. The truth is, you went away from Allah. Allah never went away from you. The truth is, you stopped praying. This morning I just spoke to someone. This person, his parents had passed away. The young man, his parents passed away, very seriously depressed. Why did Allah do this to me? I love my parents. If Allah loved me so much, why did He take my parents? I asked him, what do you prefer? What do you prefer? Do you prefer that all three of you should have died at the same time? Is that what you prefer? Or do you prefer that you should have died and they should have stayed alive because one of you or three of you, they have to die one day? Would you prefer that they be crying over you and suffer the pain? Or you, a young man who can handle the pain, rather cry over them? Why do you have to see this as an act of aggression from Allah? Maybe this was the time that they go, that they earned Allah's Jannah. And think about your mother. That same mother who made dua for you, who woke you up for Fajr, now you're saying, I don't wanna believe in Allah anymore because he took my mother. What would your mother say if she was alive? What's wrong with you? What have you done? Why are you going away from Allah? Nothing Allah does should take you away from Him. Everything He does should bring you closer to Him. This is why إِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. They ask you about me. Then let them, the first thing you need to know, not فَإِنِّي أَنَ اللَّهِ فَإِنِّي أَحَدٌ. I am one. I am the creator. No, no, no. I am the Lord of the skies and the earth. No, 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 no. When they ask you about me, when their hearts are soft and they want to know about Allah, first fill them with hope that I am near. No doubt I am near. Now I'll say something in English. I know it's going to be hard to understand, but the balagha of this ayah is absolutely mind-blowing, guys. It's incredible. If they ask you about me, tell them I am near. Does that make sense? If they ask you about me, tell them I am near. I added the words, tell them. Who should tell them? You should. They ask you, you tell them. Yes? Now what does the ayah say? وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي وَلَمْ يَقُلْ فَقُلْ لَهُمْ إِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. No, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. When they ask you about me, I am near. Allah doesn't even tell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to go and tell them, because they didn't ask Allah. Who did they ask? They asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Allah Himself moves the Prophet out of the picture and talks to them directly and says, I am near. No doubt about it. He didn't even go through the Prophet this time. Alayhi salatu wasalam. What is Allah saying? Allah is already talking to you. You're not talking to Allah. Allah is already engaged with you. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. And I am near. Now, by the way, when someone is close to you, they understand what you're going through. The further they go away from you, the less they know what you're going through. If my best friend, I moved to a different country, I don't know what he's feeling today. I got no idea. When I spend time with him, I could look at his face, I know something is wrong. You have to be close to someone to understand them. Isn't that the case? And the further away from them you get, the less you understand them. Allah Azza wa Jal describes His closeness to you. He knows your situation. He knows my situation. He knows what is making us sad. He knows what's making us angry. He knows what's making us hopeless. And He's close. Now what about dua? It's the same conversation this morning. The brother said, I make dua, but how do I make sure my du'as are answered? Allah, I keep asking and Allah just doesn't give me answer. I'm sorry, He didn't deliver the answer to you by FedEx or UPS or certified mail. Well, let's understand this a little bit. Allah says, أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. I respond immediately. You know, when you respond in Arabic, you say أَسْتَجِيبُ. But if you use the if'al pattern, you say أُجِيبُ, it means immediately. عَلَى الْفَوْرِ. I immediately respond. دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ, the single call of the one who calls. Now I'm going to spend a little bit of time on this because this is so, again, so incredible that Allah gave us this gift during the month of Ramadan. He says, I'm going to respond to someone who even called me and made dua a single time. You see, the word da'wah as opposed to dua, they say in Arabic, in sarf, they say da'wah is mastar marra. What that means is something that is done a single time. So Allah is talking about someone who never prays, never asks Allah. And in their life, one time they turned to Allah and asked. Now if that happens, if for example there's a son who never shows respect to his father, never talks to his father, never even looks at him and says salam to him, and one day he comes and says, can I have 100? Can I have 1,000? Can I borrow the car? Who are you to ask me? What have you ever done? All of a sudden you want to ask? Show me what you did for me. Isn't that the case? Allah Azza wa Jalla in this ayah says, even the one who came to Him one time, after disobeying Him an entire lifetime, He will answer immediately. Allah answers immediately. Look at the hope Allah gave this person. And this person, maybe this one who made dua is a righteous person, they're a religious person, they're a mu'min, they're a muttaqi, they're a salih. Nope. The only description Allah gives of them is ad-da'i, the one who calls. The one who calls could be a good person, could be a bad person, could be a strong believer, could be a weak believer. The one who calls could be knowledgeable, could be completely ignorant. The only thing Allah says is you have to be someone who calls. That's all. That's all that matters. I know this now, but you know, others know this much better. If all of you got a chance to speak to me for 1 minute each, If I got a chance, I want to speak to all the people. I want to speak to them for 1 minute. There's 4,000 people in the hall. That's 4,000 minutes. I'm going to die. Look, 360 minutes is already 6 hours. And that's 1 minute each. And every one of you who got 1 minute is going to complain, I only got 1 minute. And I'm going to die. I have, you know, back home I have 60 students on my campus. Somebody comes, Ustad, can I have 5 minutes? Ustad, can I have 10 minutes? Ustad, can I have 3 minutes? And I say, sure, yeah, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, 5 minutes. 5 hours later, everybody's complaining, I only got what? 5 minutes. I can't clone myself. I don't know what else to do. I am not able to respond to everybody who asks me something. I meet people all the time. Brother, I sent you an email, you didn't give me an answer. I just put my head down in shame. Like, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I get 3,000 emails a day. I don't know what to do. If I started answering emails, there would be nothing left of me. There would be a skeleton answering emails. So, I don't know what to do. But you know what? Every one of you is making a dua to Allah. And you don't make a dua at a special time. You make it whenever you feel like it. Whenever you feel like it. And every single one of you, not only does Allah respond immediately, He actually recognizes each and every one of you. He doesn't say, Ujibu da'wata da'in, some caller, ad-da'i, fahuwa ma'rufun lahu. He knows him. He is the caller to him. Allah is to you, to Allah, you are not a person, you are the person. It's amazing. It's amazing. That Allah actually acknowledges you as a special, unique individual who turned to Him and called. You are not insignificant to Allah. People will make you feel insignificant. People will say, "Who are you? Allah is going to listen to your dua? Look at you. Do you even know how to recite Quran? You're going to make dua? Shakal dekhi apni? You know? That's what people will say to you. Asif lil Arab. Asif. Ahyana nasta'amil al urdiya. La usaytir ala nafsi. Okay. So I was saying, people will make you feel like you're a bad person. So many Muslims came up to me, they want to ask a question. Ustad, I want to ask you a question. I know I'm a bad person. I was like, who told you you're a bad person? Who told you? Did Allah tell you you're a bad person? People keep telling you and you start believing it. Don't believe people, believe Allah. Allah didn't give up on you. So don't give up on yourself. This is a month to restore hope in yourself and in the people around you. You know? You're not a sinner. Even if you made mistakes today, before you came here. Even if you made mistakes today. It's not too late for you. You know? Just turn back to Allah and ask. Whenever He calls me, إِذَا دَعَانِي. Whenever He calls me. Then He says, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. Then they should respond to me. Allah, it's so beautiful. There are two words for response in Arabic. In English, I just say response. There was, you know, ujibu, ijaba, and then there's istijaba. Both are used in the ayah. And the qa'idah lughawiyya is, إِذَا اجْتَمَعَا تَفَرَّقَ. When they come together, they mean two different things. What does it mean? Allah says, I respond. Remember I keep saying, I respond immediately. Allah responds immediately. Allah responds immediately. But when He says, I expect you to respond, He didn't say immediately. He didn't say, فَلْيُجِيبُوا لِي. No, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. Then at least they should try to respond to me. Allah, He knows that I will not be able to respond in the most perfect and complete way. That my response may not even be immediate. I may be weak. But Allah wants to see my attempt. He wants to see me try. He wants to see me want to respond to Him. At least show Him some attempt, guys. Show Him some attempt. That's all He's asking for. You should be able to say to Allah, Ya Allah, I tried. And then there are those of you that are amazing losers. Amazing losers. You don't do anything, you say, I tried. You can't even be honest with yourself. Be honest to yourself. You try. Allah says, at least they should try to respond to me. Well, yu'minu bi, and continue to believe in me. You know, this is a secret to iman. When people lose hope in Allah, then the next thing to go is iman in Allah. When people don't hope in Allah anymore, then they stop believing in Allah altogether. Why should I believe in someone I can't have any hope in? So Allah says, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. Now here's the other beautiful thing about this ayah. This is such an incredible ayah. Wallahi. Here's the thing. When you ask someone for something, first thing they say is, what are you going to do for me? Isn't it? What's in it for me? You went and asked Allah for a dua. The first thing Allah should say is, what are you going to do for me? But as a matter of fact, in these ayat, you went and asked Allah, and Allah gave you immediately. You remember that? Allah gave you immediately. And then later He said, by the way, I'm giving you immediately anyway, but they should try to respond to me. He did not say, until you respond to me, I will not give you. He didn't say that. He said, I'm giving you anyway, but at least try. SubhanAllah, what a merciful Rabb we have. What a loving Rabb we have. That puts things in this, it puts us to shame how little we come before Allah. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ So they can be set straight. Look at the last words too. So they can be set straight. What does that mean? That means that through dua, no matter how bad you think you are, you can find your way back. That's what Allah is saying. If you just come back and make a little bit of an attempt, I will set you straight. Allah will put you in the right track. SubhanAllah. Your guidance is being given by Allah Azza wa Jalla. Now, what I want to share with you as I conclude, and this is actually the conclusion, inshallah, is, you know, these are not all the ayat of fasting. There are a couple more ayat, but I wanted to summarize two things here for you. When we fast, we stay away from two temptations, the temptation of food and the temptation of desire. Okay? So you stay away from your spouse out of urge, and you also stay away from food. Everybody here knows that. Now, there are basically fundamentally three motives for human beings as far as our survival is concerned. Three basic urges. There's the urge for food, of course, like animals. There's the urge for procreation, having the next you know, generation, etc. That's for us is marriage. And there's the urge for shelter, like animals. But the way we get shelter is we make money. Right? We don't build a nest or dig a cave or a hole. We make money, and that's how we get a house, and that's how we furnish a house, and we take care of ourselves. That's how we survive. That's what our shelter is. We make money. Now, fast, so there are three things then. There are three things. There is food, there's food, there's the opposite gender, and there's shelter. You with me? Two of them Allah stops us from in Ramadan, yes? Which two? He stops us from food, and He stops us from the opposite gender during the fasting time, yes? What's left? Shelter. You have an ayah coming up, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ. That's about the opposite gender. The ayah before, and then later, you know, حَتَّى يَتَبَيِّنَ لَكُمْ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطُ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. That's about food. Food in the opposite gender is covered. What's left again? Shelter. When Ramadan is done, and your taqwa is really going to be tested, the first place it will be tested will not be with food. And it will not be with your spouse. The first place your taqwa will be tested is with your money. How do I know that? Right after the ayat of fasting, what's the first thing Allah says? وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَلَا تُدْلُوا بِهَا إِلَى الْحُكَّامِ لِتَأْكُلُوا فَرِيقًا مِنْ أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ بِالْإِثْمِ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Basically, don't make money using corrupt means. Don't cheat people and make money. Be fair in your business practices. Fulfill your contracts. Don't try to be corrupt. You know, don't try to corrupt government officials. Don't use bribery. Don't use these tactics to get around justice and fairness and skimming your customer. Don't give your customer less than they deserve. You know, don't pay your workers less than they deserve. This third piece comes after Ramadan. We think that fasting is about the food and is about controlling our desire, and it ends there. But the first test of, now that you've graduated, the first test of it is, how are you going to deal with your money? SubhanAllah. It's the first thing Allah brings up. Amazing. And the last thing we think about, how do we make our money and how do we spend our money? How do we deal with people with money? You know? And this is something that needs real thought in Islam. Financial matters are of the most important matters in this religion. Look at the end of this surah. The longest ayah of the Quran is an ayah about financial issues. The longest ayah of the Quran. And even that, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Have taqwa of Allah there too. And Allah is teaching you. I'm telling you that this Ramadan is not only one in which you have to restore your relationship with the Quran, really, really turn to Allah and hope, and make dua as best you possibly can. If you don't know Arabic, it's okay, make dua in Punjabi, it's okay. You can make dua in Bangla, no problem. You can make dua in Bahasa, Somali, doesn't matter. Make dua in whatever language you can. Make dua to Allah. Allah knows all those languages, trust me. He doesn't just know Arabic. He knows. He can even, you know, understand your dua in English. When I say that, sometimes some people say, Astaghfirullah, lughat al-kufar? Yad'u Allah bi lughat al-kufar? You know, are you going to ask in the language of the kufar? There's no such thing as the language of the kufar. Every language was taught by Allah. عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ Allah taught the human being, all human beings, speech. عَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا He taught Adam alayhi salam all the names. All of us are only speaking because Adam alayhi salam was taught to speak, isn't it? So every language is a byproduct of a language, which is a byproduct of a language which came from Adam alayhi salam. So all languages are revealed. All languages are given by Allah azza wa jal. There's not one language that is inferior to another. Yes, Allah honors the Arabic language by giving it this supreme revelation, and He chose it for its special features, but doesn't mean you get to insult other languages. Turn to Allah in your language, and make dua to Allah that He makes Arabic easy for you, that He makes learning easy for you. I pray that this Ramadan is a special one for all of us, and I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal makes this Ramadan one in which we remember that this is actually truly about our identity and fulfilling that dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Man, I get so blown away by that dua. Can you just imagine? He's raising these foundations in the middle of this, like, really hot place, Makkah. It's not a tourist attraction. It's not a fun place to be. And he's building these burning rocks. They're not. There's no way to cool those rocks. You know what I'm saying? And he's building these rocks, and he's putting it together, and he makes dua that one day there will be a messenger who will recite Allah's revelations. And look at the colors in this room. Look at the people from all over the world in this room. Look at the people all over the world that are going to be reciting Quran in Ramadan, all because of one man's dua, who was standing with no camera, no audio equipment, no publications, no, you know, nothing. Standing by himself with his son making dua, and now the world is transformed because of that dua. The entire planet is a different planet because of the revelation of the Quran as a result of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. What an incredible thing. Well, if nothing else teaches you the power of dua, that should. That should make you appreciate. Here's the last, this is not part of my talk, it's just an announcement. I figured since I am in Qatar, I should share some crazy things with you. So, because I have to fly in the morning, so you won't get a chance to get angry at me, so I'll just share them with you now, inshallah. I wanted to share with you some elaborate plans that I have, and my organization, my team has. They're traveling with me, and inshallah, as we're traveling, we're going to be making lots of dua for yourselves and your community, inshallah. And I hope you do the same for us and for Bayina. I'm very grateful for, you know, all the organizations and the ministries that were involved in putting this program together. I'm really grateful for, you know, this to have come together. It was a very last minute thing. I didn't expect that it would be put together, but it was. So here's the crazy idea. I think, inshallah ta'ala, that we have an opportunity to be the loudest voice on the Quran on the entire planet. I think that we have an opportunity to, when we speak about the Quran, Muslims, non-Muslims, Hollywood, Bollywood, the media, the news industry, everybody will listen. Right now, they are louder when they speak about Islam than we are. When they criticize Islam, more people hear that than when we speak about Islam. Isn't that the case? But that doesn't have to be the case. We have the possibility, we have the ability to not only be louder than them, more influential than them, and actually instead of them influencing us and our youth, we could get to a point where we are influencing them and their youth. It can happen, and it must happen. That is the responsibility of this ummah, to turn the tide. The most powerful weapon being used on the planet today is media. It's the most powerful weapon that's being used. And we have to understand and use this weapon to the best of our ability to share the beauty and the power of the word of Allah, and wallahi al-azim, it can be done. And it's very easy. It's not hard. It seems impossible, but it's not. It is not. With the help of Allah Azza wa Jal, anything is possible. With the help of Allah, and if Allah Azza wa Jal can take that one man's dua who had no media, which man am I talking about? Ibrahim alayhi salam. He could take that one man's dua, and now a fifth of the world's population puts their head down before the house of Allah that he built, and recites the word based on his dua. Then we should know that Allah is capable, when this many countless Muslims exist all over the planet. If they put even a millionth, a billionth of the effort and the sincerity in dua that Ibrahim alayhi salam put in, we can transform this planet. I have no doubt whatsoever. I have no doubt whatsoever. There are so many people looking for Islam. There are so many people who are having doubts about Islam that need help. These are not criminals. These are not bad people. They just don't have access to the right resources. We can provide those resources. I don't want to tell you what the plan is, but I do want to tell you it's coming out in Ramadan. I have a crazy plan. And you're going to hear about it in Ramadan. And I'm hoping that Allah Azza wa Jal gives it the kind of barakah that it needs to be able to take wings. And I think it can. Wallahi, I believe that it can. Because when you sincerely try to spread the word of Allah on this earth, then I don't make it successful, you don't make it successful, it is Allah Azza wa Jal who makes it successful. He's the one, just like, you know, rain comes all over the earth and life comes out, just like that Allah compares rain to the Quran. When the Quran starts coming all over the earth, iman will come out of the earth. People will come out of the woodworks. There are going to be nations that you would never think would ever believe, like a desert. But when it rains, life comes out. Just greenery comes out and people will come to iman. It can happen. So I'm hoping, inshallah ta'ala, you look out for the crazy thing I'm going to do with my team in Ramadan, and you guys support it bi-ithnillah ta'ala. I think together as an ummah, we are very powerful. Don't let anybody tell you we're weak. We're not weak. Don't let anybody tell you they get to say whatever they want to us or do whatever they want with us or, you know, insult us however they want. They are only doing that because we're sleeping. That's the only, not because we're weak, because we're sleeping. We just have to wake up. That's it. That's all we have to do. We just open our eyes and this is a different planet. And I think, inshallah ta'ala, we can do it together. We have to, this is not a one-man thing. It's not a two-man thing. This is an ummah thing. When the ummah starts waking up, things change. Inshallah ta'ala, I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal makes us the generation that changed the tide of history. We're the generation that every generation before us kept saying, things are getting worse, things are getting worse, things are getting worse. And this generation comes around and things have been better than they've ever been. We can do it, inshallah ta'ala. May Allah Azza wa Jal make this month of the Quran the month where the tide of this ummah changes. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullahu khairan. I'm going to stick around for 30 minutes. I'm going to be over there. I'm not going to take selfies. If you have a question, I would love to hear it. I will give one brother and one sister a chance for 30 minutes. No selfies. Learn Photoshop. Okay.